alabanza. Golpe de guerra.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to Sunday Night Live with Pasadena Church. I know with that intro, you might have thought you were tuning into the wrong program, but usually this time of the year, we're in Cuba ministering the Word of God and doing worship concerts there. So I thought I would begin with a little Cuban flavor. And as we go into the service today, I'm going to give you a few more little touches of that Cuban inspiration from the music that we share there. But we're glad to have you with us today. And it's a blessing that you've joined us. And we're so thankful that you've tuned in today. And we're expecting to have a good time in the Lord. You're here at the right time because we've been learning about the church and what it means to be the church, the relevant, authentic church that Jesus built, not the man-made institution that we've seen on full display. And I can't wait to share more about that with you later. But first, come on, let's go into a time of worship. Let's worship the Lord together. You see, when we worship, beloved, we make room for God to come in and to dwell in our midst. That's what we need. We need God to be here with us. I don't know about you, but I know I need the Lord. I need His presence. And the Bible tells us in His presence, there's fullness of joy. And at His right hand, there are pleasures evermore. So when we worship, we invite the Lord's presence into where we are. We're going to do that tonight. And we want to come back after worshiping with a word I believe the Lord has for you tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Go ahead and clap your hands.
I'm I lift my hands in total adoration unto you. You reign on the throne, for you are God and God alone. Because of you, my cloudy days are gone. I can sing to you this song. I just wanna say that I love you more than anything. Sing with me. I lift my hands in total adoration unto you. You reign on the throne, for you are
Y si no me oyes decir otra cosa,
unless I say different,
a menos que lo diga de una manera diferente,
I love you,
te lo digo de nuevo,
but I'm
te amo.
Saying it all the time.
Te lo voy a decir todo el tiempo.
And she looked at him and said,
y ella lo mira de vuelta y le dice,
you probably have another thought coming.
Probablemente tengas otro pensamiento que te venga en ese momento.
Because you're going to need to say that more than once.
Porque vas a repetir lo mismo una y otra vez.
For me to believe you.
Para que yo te crea.
Tell Jesus you love him.
Así que dile a Jesús que lo amas.
More than once. More than once.
Una vez más. Una vez más. Más de una vez, díselo.
Thank you, Jesus.
Gracias, Jesús.
Good morning, church family. God bless you. Sure wish we were in person so I could hug your neck and we could pray and fellowship and worship the Lord together. But we gonna worship him right from our homes on our computers. Amen. Amen. Either way, I want you to extend your faith with me this morning as we go into prayer. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we come to you by the authority given to us in Jesus Christ, by Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Lord, we ask you to give every believer hearing me and agreeing with this prayer the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Lord, that the eyes of our understanding would be enlightened to know the hope of your calling, to know the riches of the glory of your inheritance in the saints, and to know what is the exceeding greatness of your power towards us who believe according to the working of your mighty power which you showed us, showed forth in Christ Jesus when you raised him from the dead and seated him at your own right hand in heavenly places. Far above all principality, power, might, and dominion, in every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. God, and had put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, the body of Christ, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Father, I ask in the name of Jesus that you would grant unto us according to the riches of your glory to be strengthened with might by your spirit in our inner man, that Christ would dwell in our hearts richly by faith. Lord God, that we being rooted and grounded in love would be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height of the love of God, that we would know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and that we would be filled with all the fullness of you. Thank you, Father, for giving us wonderful ministry gifts, the gift of the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers. Lord God, these ministry gifts that help us to mature and grow strong in you so that the body of Christ, we would be built up, that we would walk in love, that we would serve one another. Lord, that we would come into the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God and become perfect, Lord God, or become mature in Christ Jesus, so that we would no longer also be tossed to and fro by false teachings and doctrines by men and those that would come to deceive us, Lord God, but that we, and these gifts, they help us to grow up in Christ and always speak the truth in love. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Father, we also desire to be filled with the knowledge of your will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding so that we may walk worthy of you, pleasing you by every fruitful work that we do and increase in the knowledge of you. Father, that we would be strengthened with might according to your glorious power and unto all patience, long-suffering with joyfulness. God, we thank you, thank you, thank you for making us able to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in life. That we thank you, Lord God, for delivering us from the power of darkness and translating us into the kingdom of your dear Son, in whom we have redemption and the forgiveness of sins through his blood. God, we thank you for being kind to us, for loving us, and for blessing us with peace. God, we thank you right now for the word that is working mightily in us, causing us to want to do those things that please you. Father, thank you for hearing us. Thank you, Lord God, for answering as we've agreed in prayer. We prayed according to your will and your word. We believe we receive it right now. We thank you. We thank you. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody that agree with that prayer, say amen and amen. Beloved, you are God's best. Believe it. God bless you.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Just enjoying that worship today. You might have that second song with Bishop Joseph Garlington singing More Than Anything when we were in Holguín, Cuba one year. And just love the bishop, and his voice inspires me. One of the first times I heard a pastor who sings, and I realized I can still sing and be a pastor and preach and all of that. So I'm so thankful for the bishop. And later on, I want to share a little bit of that same song from a rehearsal. It just went totally Cuban on that same song. It's amazing. We'll do that at the end of the service. But first, I want to share with you today the topic, what makes the church the church? Let's talk about it today. What makes the church the church? That's the title of our message. And we want you to think about that. It's something I want you to begin to let it marinate in your heart, because this is very important for those of us who are really desiring to be all that God's created us to be and to do all that He's called us to do. What makes the church the church? And if you know me, anyone who knows me, you know by now that I have an interesting imagination. Let's just say it that way. That's a nice way of saying it. And my brain is able to memorize by association. That's how I remember names and things like that. And I'm often able to remember someone's name by associating it with something or someone else. And as a matter of fact, even when we're out and about with my family, they'll tell you, I'm often spotting doppelgangers. You know, doppelgangers is another way my mind works. Someone who looks like someone else or looks like someone famous. And this keeps my mind fresh. And then I make those associations with people, and it helps me to remember. And as I begin thinking about what I was going to share with you today, what makes a church, interesting. My mind started going there again. And there were two particular songs that came to my mind. Both of them reminded me of how I wanted to frame what I wanted to say to you today. And the first one comes from my childhood. I can't tell you when I heard it and when I learned it, but there was a nursery rhyme type of song that said, "What are little girls made of? What are little girls made of? Sugar and spice and everything nice. That's what little girls are made of." And then the second verse said, "What are little boys made of?" And that was interesting to me. "And what are little boys made of?" And then they said, "Boys are made of frogs and snails and puppy dog tails." I was like, good Lord, why do the brothers get a bad rep? You know, but nevertheless, that song was in my mind as I was thinking about what's the church all about and what's the church made of. And the second song actually that comes to mind was a song that was originally released by Dionne Warwick, but it was made popular in my generation by a R&B balladeer by the name of Luther Vandross. Anybody remember Luther? Come on, some of y'all remember Luther. You ain't been saved that long to remember Luther. That song, "A House Is Not a Home." And Luther would come in, "Doo, doo, doo." Don't go back too far now. Luther would sing and shake his head. Boy, and just take us there, right? I better stop. I still gotta preach today. Hallelujah. Come on, Brother Luther. But Luther sang this song, "A House Is Not a Home." And the lyrics said something like this. It said, "A chair is still a chair, even when there's no one sitting there." And then Luther would say, "But a chair is not a house. And a house is not a home when there's no one there to hold you tight and no one there to kiss goodnight." Hallelujah. But the part that really got me thinking was when he says, "I'm not meant to live alone. Turn this house into a home. When I climb the stairs and turn the key, oh, please be there saying that you're still in love with me." Say that you're still there. You're still in love with me. And you may be saying, "Oh Lord, Pastor, what's the association?" Well, here it is. We've been sharing messages about the church, what it is and what it isn't. what it does and what it doesn't do, and so on. And today, I want us to move into what makes the church the church. Just like what makes a house a home is not the chair, is not the room, but it's the relationship. And just like those two songs, I believe people need to know what the church is made of and what's the difference between the church and the world, between church people and unchurched people. I'll tell you right now, it's not what we think. It's not what we often hang our religious hats on. It's much simpler, and it can be understood if and only if we look to the Word of God, so that we can really begin to share and live in a way where people can see what the church is made of and who the church is made of. And the second thing, paraphrasing Brother Luther's words, a building is still a building. A building is not a church. A group of people who dress up on Sunday and gather to perform rituals is not a church. It's definitely not the church. It's only the church if Christ is at the center of it all. And this is a part of the message that's been manipulated and distorted to lead people astray. But we have to understand what the church, what it means to really be the church. Hallelujah. And I recall, and I want to bring you back. Come on, let's go back into the Word of God, to the words of Christ himself. Jesus said it in Matthew chapter 16 when he was establishing his church. You remember, we've preached on it before. After Peter's revelation that Jesus is the Messiah, he said, flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you, Peter, but my Father in heaven. And then he says, here it is. Come on, let's read it together. Hope you got your Bibles with you. Come on. The Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 16, verse 18. In the CEV, this is what Christ says. He says, so I will call you Peter, which means a rock. And on this rock, which is this revelation that you've just shared, I will build my church, and death itself will not have any power over it. Amen. Lord, bless your word. I believe, my friends, that there are a whole lot of people who've joined the church for the wrong reasons. In the same way, and even more so, I believe there's a whole lot of people who have left the church for the wrong reasons. I mean, when you have an authentic understanding of the church, not as a building, not as a clique of people who often disappoint and fail at interpersonal relationships, but when we get a true look at the church of Christ, his church, as the body of Christ, we will realize that it's not about leaving, but it's about cleaving, staying connected as members of his body. I hear you. I can hear it through the screen. But Pastor, you don't understand. Pastor, you haven't seen what I've seen in the churches I've been a part of. You haven't been hurt like I've been hurt by church folk. Well, you want to bet? That's what we used to say growing up. Want to bet? Most, if not all, of my wounds, my friends, have come from my past church experiences and the people who I thought were for me that ended up hurting me deeply. So my friends, I get it. I understand why so many people have been disappointed and discouraged by their church experience and history, even to the point of having to disconnect from those local expressions of his body. However, you need to know, and I'm saying to you, I believe this is specifically to someone that's watching today, you are still a part of the body of Christ. And it would be to your advantage, my friend, to reconnect, to get plugged back into a healthy place where you can fellowship, enjoy fellowship, and serve together with other members of his body, of his church. You see, I believe toxic Christianity has had its way too long. We must reclaim our identity as the people, the family of God, and work on loving him and loving each other. and living in such a way that when people encounter us, when they meet us and experience us, they leave saying to themselves, I want what they have. I want to be connected to that family of God, to those people. Amen. That's a good place to say amen. Come on, you can just say amen. Hallelujah. What makes the church the church? I guess I'm saying to you today that it's not too late to give up on what the Lord has established as his church. It's not too late to come back to that. However, we must take responsibility for the way things appear, and we must dispel the false messages and the false representations of Christianity that flood the airways and confuses the world. When they look at the church, or when they listen to us. So then we begin to see now why it's imperative for us to talk about what makes the church the church. Can we talk about it today? Come on, let's talk about it. You know, as I was thinking about this, I thought about the television show Shark Tank, and sometimes people present on Shark Tank to get the investments of these sharks to help them with their businesses. And every now and then they'll have an idea they'll present, and the sharks will say, well, what's behind that? What makes it successful? Or how do you believe it's gonna make it work? And they say, well, there's a proprietary blend. And whenever you hear proprietary blend, that's somebody saying, I'm not going to tell you what it really is because you might take it from me or something like that. But when we talk about what makes the church, it's not a special sauce. It's not about a secret handshake that believers have with one another that makes you a part of the church. No, it's very clear and it's simple if we go into the Word. The proprietary blend, amen, is available to anyone who would open the Word and open their hearts and receive. As a matter of fact, that's my first point today. We talk about what makes the church. Number one, we are the church because we receive Christ. We receive Christ. Not only do we receive him, but we also repent. Receiving Christ and repenting, those two things are so important to making us the church. And anyone who claims to be a part of the Lord's church or part of him as the body of Christ. So when you say I'm a part of the Lord's church, you're really saying I'm a part of Christ. He's the head of my life. And anyone who claims that must receive Christ and must repent. Metanoel, the word repent, it's saying we become the church when we accept, first of all, the wonderful gift of salvation through Christ. And by receiving the gospel into our hearts, we're able to have a change of mind, to repent and to accept his way over our ways. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. You see, at its basic form, to repent means to change one's way of life as the result of a complete change of thought and attitude with regard to sin and righteousness. To repent, to change one's ways. And we can only do this when we receive this wonderful gift that Christ offers everyone who would accept it. See, friends, we find an amazing summary of the impact that the arrival and life of Christ would have on the world. We find it in the Gospel of John. That's one place we can look. This includes in John 1, it includes explaining the results of receiving him, welcoming Christ into our lives. What happens when we do that? Let's look at it together in John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. Here it is. This is what it says. It says, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. When we receive Christ into our lives, when we receive the wonderful message of the gospel of Christ, he brings us into the family of God and we become his. We are, as he tells Nicodemus in John chapter 3, we're born again. And being born again gives us an opportunity to live free of all of the things that trap us, that condemn us, that shame us, and that press us down. When we receive Christ, those things are lifted off of us and we become a part of him, a part of his body, and a part of his church. And that's what makes the church the church. You see, friends, every person who receives Christ automatically becomes a part of his body, a part of his church. I'm sorry to spoil it for some of y'all, but it's not shaking the preacher's hand or going to the front of the church and sitting in that chair or even taking classes, which we have in our ministry. That doesn't make you a part of the church. It begins with receiving Christ. It begins with this salvation experience. Another place we find this, of course, is in Romans 10, 9 and 10. I mean, this is a key scripture here. It's something that if you are a Christian, you should memorize Romans 10, 9 and 10, because it will give you an opportunity to share. You will have many opportunities to share this scripture with people who may not know Christ and they want to know him. You can simply quote and recite what the writer says here in Romans. Let's read it together. Paul says in verse 9, if you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God. And it's by openly declaring your faith that you are saved. I learned it in the old King James. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised from the dead, you'll be saved. But the truth is revealed here in this translation as well. Confessing with our mouth, openly declaring that Jesus is Lord and believing. And when we believe, what we're really doing, we're receiving the truth of that confession into our lives, and it changes everything. We're talking about a game changer. Jesus is a game changer for all of us, Christ receiving him. And I'm so thankful as I thought about this truth, I thought about my conversion experience. The day, September 15th, 1985, I'll never forget it, when I asked Jesus into my heart. And he saved me. I confessed with my mouth, believed in my heart, and he saved me. I began to try to live in a way that would honor him, but I still had some stuff going on in my life that made it a little shaky at first. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Come on, a little shaky at first. And sometimes it caused me to question and other people would question me because they saw me go up to the front, but then they saw me or heard me at school or on the bus, heard me say something that did not align with what they saw at the altar. But I'm so thankful today, anybody from Toledo, Ohio watching, I'm so thankful. We call her mother now, but back then she was Sister Mary Ann Dunstan. I'm so thankful for Sister Dunstan. She was our choir director. She's the one who basically forced me to start singing in the choir between her and my mother. That's a whole nother story. I'll tell y'all about that one later. But I remember shortly after coming to Christ and giving my heart to the Lord, me and my best friend Lamar, who's a pastor, just prayed the prayer earlier. Me and Pastor Lamar got saved on the same day. And we were walking together and we were out in the world together. We got saved and now we're trying to reconcile our faith now. And Sister Dunstan pulled us aside one day, both of us, and she looked us in the eye, got up close, as the old saints would do, got up in our face, and she said this, I'll never forget it. She said, don't ever let anyone tell you that you're not saved. And at the time, we were on cloud nine. We were saved. We were witnessing to people. We were excited about Christ. But she knew that there was a time that was coming when we may question or others may question it. But she said, don't let anybody tell you you're not saved. And my friends, let me tell you, these words helped preserve my life when I didn't think I could make it. And when I was still working out of the old software in my life after confessing Christ, these words still rang true in my heart because she knew, Sister Mary Ann Dunstan, she knew what I didn't know at the time. And that was that God would fulfill his purpose and calling for my life if I just didn't give up. That's what she meant when she said, don't let anybody tell you not saved, not people, not even the devil. And I thank God to this day I am saved because she shared that with me, and I lived by it. And I still to this day I'm thankful for Sister Mary Ann Dunston. Come on, y'all say Sister Mary Ann Dunston. Come on, type it in there. She's going to be so excited when she hears that somebody said that her son told everybody to say her name. Hallelujah. She's still alive too. Amen. Thank God for Sister Dunston. We receive Christ. Number two, we respond to Christ. The second point is this. The church, what makes the church is that we respond to Christ. You see, another way to say this is that we answer to Christ alone. It's His voice, His commands that we must that must guide every true believer. This response to His voice serves as a protectant from the enemy of our souls. The enemy of our souls often disguises His voice to confuse us and to lead us astray. That's what the devil does. But when we receive Christ, we now are enabled to respond to His voice and His voice alone. We can now follow His ways and we can live for Him. Jesus said it in the Gospel of John chapter 10. I hope you still got your Bibles with you. Come on, let's look at John 10 verses 27 through 29. I want to read all three verses. Here it is. This is what the Lord says. He says, my sheep recognize my voice and I know them and they follow me, not another. He says, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one shall snatch them away from me. Thank you, Lord. For my Father has given them to me and He is more powerful than anyone else. So no one can kidnap them from me. I love this translation here. You see, another revelation that comes from just reading that here is that eternal life is not as easy to lose as we think it is. Some of us have sent people to hell because we saw them say, heard them say something or saw them do just one thing. But Jesus said it. Did you hear it? He said, no one shall snatch them away from me. And I believe that it's not our place to major in determining if people are going to hell or to heaven. That's not our place. The truth is, only God knows. Only God knows our hearts. And only God knows where we stand with Him. And we know that in our heart of hearts, but He's the only one. As a matter of fact, I got a question for you if you're still debating what you're hearing me say. You remember the thief? You remember the thief on the cross, right? The one next to Jesus who said, Lord, when you enter into your kingdom, remember me. Yeah, you remember that one. And Jesus said to him, today, you'll be with me in paradise. They were both dying. And everybody that knew that guy, I would think, they knew that he deserved to die. They knew that he was a bad person while he was alive and before he was on the cross. They knew why he was hanging on the cross. But do you think that his family and friends and even his enemies, do you think they knew that he made it to heaven? Probably the last time they saw him, he was doing something that led him to the cross, but they didn't have or hear the conversation that he had with the Savior on his way out. And Jesus said, today you're going to be with me in paradise. And we already know that there's a whole lot of folk that we think will be in heaven who are going to miss heaven. And a whole lot of folk that we think should be burning in hell. Amen. They're going to enjoy eternal life in heaven because only God knows. So our focus, my friends, must be on His voice. Let's just focus on His voice, not worrying about what other people think or do. And let me say this, His voice is the clearest in His word. The Bible is the word of God. And if you want to understand and follow the voice of the Lord, read the word of God, as we say around here, until the word of God reads you, because the word it's inspired by God. The Bible tells us that all scripture is God breathed. So when you read the word, you're reading the word of God. So you're hearing His voice. You're responding to it. Receive, respond. Number three, I know we're almost done. The third point is this. What makes the church is simply that those who are part of His church, we live resurrected lives. You know, I had to have another R, receive, respond, resurrected lives. As a matter of fact, that simply means that we, in our accepting or receiving the gospel, in our responding to his voice, now we understand, not that we're better than anybody. The church, people in the church aren't better than people outside of the church. Pastors aren't better than physicians or teachers or steel workers. Amen. We're all people. This is humanity. We're all a part of. But the difference becomes Christ. The difference becomes the reality that we have received him, and we have, as a result, the life that we lived, our former ways. You remember that message, the Church of Hypocrites and Liars, and the list that we were all on. We don't have to be on that list anymore. This matter of resurrected lives is just accepting what Christ has done for us. I love the book of Ephesians because it speaks to the church directly. And Ephesians chapter 2 just states it so clearly. And I can talk about it, but I'd rather just read it to you. Ephesians 2 verses 1 through 3. Listen to what it says in the CEV. Paul says, in the past, you were dead because you sinned and fought against God. Listen to this word. In the past, you were dead. How can you be dead in the past? Well, he's going to explain it. You followed the ways of this world and obeyed the devil. He rules the world, and his spirit has power over everyone who doesn't obey God. Once we were also ruled by the selfish desires of our bodies and minds. We had made God angry, and we were going to be punished like everyone else. Amen. That's what the scripture tells us. We were dead even while we were alive, but because we were set in our old ways, which were sinful ways, and we were going to receive the punishment that sin requires. The wages of sin is death. This shows us that sin, this shows us in these first few verses what sin does to us. Sin kills us, even though we may still be breathing. He's saying here, you were dead men walking. But the good news is that the story doesn't have to end there because of Christ. So just like sometimes when somebody walks out of the movie before it's over, you're going to miss the good part. And I don't want you to walk out right now. Let's keep reading right here in Ephesians. Keep going. Verses 4 through 6, chapter 2. This is the good news. He says, but God was merciful. We were dead because of our sins, but God, come on, somebody just hashtag, but God loved us so much that he made us alive with Christ. And God's wonderful kindness is what saves you. God raised us from death to life. Remember number 3, resurrected lives. He raised us from death to life with Christ Jesus, and he has given us a place beside Christ in heaven. Hallelujah. Thank you for your word, Lord. How is this possible that God raised us with Christ? Well, the Bible says in another Ephesians 1:19 and somewhere around there, it says the same power that raised Christ from the dead, he's given to us. And when we identify ourselves as his church, as his body, we also claim that resurrection power for ourselves. I've said it before. He didn't just raise the head of Christ. He raised all of Christ, his head and his body. So in another place, the Bible tells us that Christ is the head of his church, his body. So when he was raised, we were raised also. So we don't have to subscribe to sin any longer. We don't have to yield to sinful ways or patterns or behaviors. We die to those things so that we can live in Christ. He says it one more time in Galatians. I'm going to give you one more scripture. It's made possible through the revelation that Paul gives in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I learned it in the King James Version, and I'm going to read it in Old King Jimmy today, KJV. Paul says it this way. Listen, he says, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We are only the church and can only live accordingly because we died with Christ and have been raised with him, freeing us from the sin and the shame that imprisoned us before. So what you see is Christ in me. Those of us who are part of his church, what makes the church is that the people who have received Christ and that are actively a part of his body, we are living not ourselves in and of ourselves, but it's Christ living in us. It's the only difference. Doesn't make us better than anyone else. We understand that we've been forgiven and we've accepted that and we're living in that, not our old selves. When I say my old self, it reminds me, the last thing I'll share with you is a few years ago, I went to my 30th high school reunion at Jessup W. Scott High School, them Bulldogs, you know, the best school in Toledo, Ohio, of course. All the Bulldogs, come on, just bark at me, do something. But my 30th reunion was wonderful because when I left high school, I was on my way down another path. All of my friends thought I was going to an HBCU in Ohio, Central State University, the Marching Marauders. I was going to be in their band. I was entered into their pre-med program, and everybody thought, you know, that was me. And even back then in high school, my nickname was Daddy. So everybody was like, Daddy's going to Central State. Oh, Daddy's going to be a doctor. He's going to be in the band. And we left that way. But what they didn't know was that same summer, the Lord began to work on my heart, and I got saved. Remember that earlier that September. Now, as I'm making these final preparations for college, the Lord touches my heart and leads me another direction. I didn't go to that school. I ended up going to school in Indiana. It's a wonderful thing because I met my wife there, and the Lord began to that formation process for ministry for me. But 30 years later, my classmates didn't know that. So when we arrived at our reunion, you know, hey, Daddy, and everybody's calling me by my old name and all of that. And I think some of them knew because of Facebook and all of that, but a lot of them didn't understand what that really meant. But one of my friends who did, she said she was planning it. She says, well, we want to do our reunion this weekend, and on Sunday, we want all of our classmates to go to church. Can you go back to your old church and ask, can you preach? We'd love for you to preach. And my pastor, of course, Pastor Colt, he said, yeah, that'd be great. So all of my classmates came to church that Sunday, and I was able to explain to them that Daddy was dead. I was able to explain to them that the Kerwin Manning that they knew and loved in high school, I'm not the same guy anymore, because of Christ. And the things that I used to do have all been washed in the blood of Jesus. And now I'm a new person. And the person that you see, I don't mind you calling me Daddy, but I'm a child of God. And I was able to share this message with my classmates and friends. Many of them stood that afternoon to receive Christ and then came to the altar to receive Christ. One of the greatest moments in my life, to be able to share with my friends, the same ones who saw me doing my dirt and all the stuff I used to do, to hear the way that Christ has changed my life. And that's what makes the church the church. I mean, you know, receiving Christ, responding to Christ, and then living a resurrected life. I'm gonna stop there. I'd like to pray with you and have you pray with me if you don't mind. Let's just pause and ask the Lord's blessing over this word. And I pray that you will hear even beyond the way I've tried to articulate it to you, and that the Spirit of God would speak to your heart, so that even if you're watching right now and you want to become a Christian, you want to become a follower of Christ, you can pray a simple prayer with me at the end of this prayer. And upon your confession of that faith that Jesus is Lord and believing in your heart, you'll be saved. Amen. Father, thank you for this opportunity to share this word today. Lord, I pray that you will take these words and fashion them in a way, I believe you've already done it, that will speak to the hearts of the listeners, those listening and watching. Pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, for your transforming power to touch the lives, especially those today I feel impressed to pray for those who have been disappointed by the church or their church experience. I pray that they would return and reconnect and find this time, God, is not about the people or the building or the processes, but it's about what's going on in our hearts as we receive you and respond to you and choose to live resurrected lives in community with others. Pray that you would bless and strengthen your people and strengthen your church. And I pray for those, Father, who may not even have a relationship with you but desire to have one, even as we pray this prayer. According to your promise, Lord, you'll touch their lives and save them. My friend, will you just pray these words with me? As a matter of fact, everybody pray this. Dear Jesus, I ask you into my heart. I receive you as my Savior and Lord. And I believe you, Lord Jesus, that you gave your life that I might have life. And according to the scripture, you were resurrected on the third day. And that same resurrection power I receive now in my life. And I declare from this day forward that I'm saved. I'm whole. I'm yours. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, thank you so much for watching today. And if you pray that prayer with me, my friend, do something. Do this for me. Text the words, I believe. Text the words, I believe, to the number on your screen, 626-602-1165. If you can't do that, go to our website, PasadenaChurch.com, and on the front page, there's a little tab that says decision card. You press that button, you can fill out that information so that we can stay connected with you and let us know that you've made a decision to follow Christ. Those of you who have been tracking with us, you know that we've been reading the Gospels every day. We're reading one chapter a day. We started in the book of Matthew, and today we actually begin the Gospel of Mark. So you can jump in and join us, beginning with Mark chapter 1 today. We'd love for you to do that. And then for our entire church, listen to me, everyone who's a part of Pasadena Church, and if you live in the city of Pasadena, this evening at 6 p.m., we're going to have a citywide Zoom prayer. Many of our churches from around our city, we're going to be praying together on a Zoom call, and we want and expect you to be a part of that. The meeting ID is on your screen, 981. Take a screenshot if you need to, 981-9356-2559. That's 981-9356-2559. And the password is prayer2021. Prayer 2021. Join us today at 6 p.m. If you're watching the 6 p.m. service, I'm sorry you've missed it, but you can join us next time because we are going to do it again. We want you to continue to join us in prayer every morning at 6 a.m. I'm on our United Prayer line, 609-663-5949, Monday through Fridays at 6 a.m. Come on, join us in prayer as we pray together, share testimonies together. It's a wonderful time. I tell people it's better than a bowl of Wheaties. You can also partner with us financially. If you'd like to be a part of what God is doing here, by giving, you can join our members because our members support our church primarily through their tithes and offerings. But our friends also, you're more than welcome to give. The ways that you can give are listed on your screen through the website, through the Cash and Zelle apps. You can text You Matter to the number on your screen. A lot of different ways, and you can just send it in to our church address that's on there as well. But more than anything, we're just thankful for every gift that comes and that allows us to continue to do the work we believe the Lord has called us to do. Now, come on, keep following us. Follow us on Facebook. You can follow us on YouTube. And just know that we are excited to have you to be a part of what God is doing here. I'm going to send you out with a little bit of that More Than Anything from a rehearsal with the Cuban flavor. So as you enjoy that at the end, just know that we love you, we believe in you, and you matter to God.